How would you define heavy metal?
define it. Well, it's just, you know. I don't know.
That's such an open-ended question.
Ooh.
That's a tough one.
Go on, another question.
I don't know, actually.
It's always been an extraordinarily difficult thing to try and talk about because you have to hear it, you have to experience it.
We are the lost generation, people who don't necessarily fit in.
It's a lot of white boy angst.
Metal is all about stirring up the pot.
It was just about
want to fight you.
It's like having a 5 foot.
Yeah! You feel the sound. It hits you right here.
It's that anarchy. It's that stuff that makes your parents wet themselves when they're thinking about what their kids may or may not be doing.
El hecho de que el heavy metal haya nacido a finales de los 60 sorprende mucho. En ese tiempo la música pop hablaba de paz y amor, pero aquellos que se interesaron en ver más allá de la superficie descubrieron que no todas las ciudades eran como San Francisco. Otros lugares tenían una historia más oscura que contar.
Second World War in Birmingham. That's where all the ammunition was made. That's why it got so heavily bombed. So there's a lot of, you know, bricks all over the place and bombed out buildings, all that kind of stuff.
If you look at the times, it was all love and peace and bells and, you know, free love. And that wasn't the case for industrial, stenchy town in Birmingham.
It was very rough, really, very industrial sort of town.
There's heavy industry of all descriptions in and around Birmingham.
That's why it's called the Black Country. Coal mines and the smoke. As kids growing up, that was embedded in your mentality.
I remember as a kid being in class, and next door to the school was one of these big metal foundries. And you'd be in class trying to study, and you could actually hear the metal hammers and the compressors banging and spitting forth metal and all this smoke, and it was drifting into the classroom, and your books on the desk would be bouncing. You could actually physically feel it. So I sometimes think that's the culprit, you know. I actually breathed that metal into my lungs. It got into my blood.
Algunos dicen que el heavy metal se percibe desde el sonido distorsionado de las guitarras de Kings o Jimi Hendrix, o en la épica y nagada vida de Iron Butterfly. Pero el verdadero metal nació en el infierno industrial de Birmingham en un día común de 1968, que se trastornó asquerosamente para mal.
I worked in a factory doing welding and stuff. It's really peculiar because I was going to leave the job that day. I just joined the band. And we were going to tour Germany and whatever else. So it was my last day, if you like, and there was nothing for me to do. They said, well, the person that cuts the sheet metal wasn't in that day, and so they said, would you cut it? Because you can't, otherwise you've got nothing to do. So they put me on this sheet metal machine that comes down and chops and bends metal. Of course, I had not a clue about it. I'd never worked on it before. And I got my hand in it, just went straight down. And because as I pulled my hand back, I took the two ends off. So after that happened, of course, that blew everything. I was just devastated. I thought I'd never. I went into such a deep depression.
He was told by his doctors that that was the end, you know. But, you know, a guy like Tony Iommi, tremendously driven person. And you weren't going to leave a guy like that behind. He invented his own prosthesis.
He had to make false fingers, really. And he made them out of old plastic bottle tops that he'd melt onto his fingers and then put some leather over the top for the grip.
You know, he's thinking, what the hell am I going to do with this? It hurts to play with him. He figured out he could tune down. He could detune and play with these plastic fingers. The sound is actually thicker and heavier, and it's a core of the Black Sabbath sound.
Because I took the ends of my fingers off, it made me create a different style of playing, which was great, really, because eventually it became heavy metal.
The big thing for Tony Iommi was the discovery of the Devil's Third. Da da da. That very close movement in the music was literally banned in medieval times because they thought, it's a fact, they thought that it conjured the devil.
That's one of those things that, man, you know, as a guitar player, a songwriter, you wish you could have wrote because you were defined immediately.
Before that, we were playing bluesy jazz, you know, and it just went into this. I don't think we can explain it.
A la banda que se conocía originalmente como Air, se unió el cantante Ozzy Osbourne, un carnicero bipolar.
I've always been a very rebellious type of a person from the age of whatever. My father said to me before he died that he always expected me to be in prison all my life, you know, because I just wouldn't conform to the system.
En la batería estaba el soldador Bill Ward y en el bajo Geezer Butler, un contador frustrado aficionado a la brujería.
It's hard to explain to people, but it was like a very close unit, and we had this thing going on with each other that was very strange. And Geezer in particular had all sorts of weird dreams and weird thoughts. You know. It might have been the acid, I don't know.
At the time, I was seriously into cult stuff and black magic and all that kind of thing. I had this little apartment, which I'd painted back black and had all these upside-down crosses all around the place. Pictures of Satan everywhere. And Ozzy brought this book around for me, and it's like this really old 15th century like old book, and it was all written in Latin. It was all about black magic. It had all these like drawings of Satan and everything in it, and I just had a really weird feeling about it. And that same night I woke up in the middle of this horrible nightmare, and I just saw this like black shape at the bottom of my bed, just like staring at me. It was like a black, malevolent thing. It's a horrible feeling off it, and I just totally freaked out. And I told Ozzy about it, and he came up with the lyrics to Black Sabbath.
What is this that's done?
It was very different, and we knew it was very different when we'd done it. It was almost frighteningly different, you know.
Feather in black, where it points at me.
We had these gigs at the blues clubs, and we thought, should we play that song we'd done? We were trying to see what the reaction would be, and we played Black Sabbath, and God, the people's faces when they heard that.
La canción inspiró al grupo a cambiarse el nombre a Black Sabbath. Decían, vamos a asustar a la gente. Con $600 grabaron su primer disco del mismo título y a dos días de haber salido a la venta, el viernes 13 de febrero de 1970, se colocaría como uno de los discos más importantes en la historia de la música.
You only have to say Black Sabbath. That's what heavy metal music is about.
Thank God for that, or thank Satan for that.
Every band that plays this kind of music today takes something from it.
¿Cómo respondieron los críticos a este logro musical que inició una revolución hace ya cuatro décadas?
The reviews were unanimous.
Absolutely awful in most of the reviews.
Some of it was really got slammed.
Nobody thought Black Sabbath was
making art.
One thing you can say about rock journalists is soothsayers they ain't.
When the album came straight in the charts and went up to like number three or something in England, and it pissed them, totally pissed them all off. Because it made them look stupid. We were still like 18, 20 years old, and so it really appealed to kids of our age. And it was something that the kids had for themselves, kind of thing. It was like a secret, almost.
Thank you very much, it's all from Rock Center, thank you.
Zeppelin was, you know, another stratosphere. The guitar playing, the style, the look, the mysticism, it's all very metal.
So you're considered the father of heavy metal. When's the first time you heard the term?
I've never classed ourselves as heavy metal. We've always been heavy rock in my mind. And the first time I heard heavy metal was when I went back to England one time. And I'm doing this interview and this guy said, oh, you know, about heavy metal. I went, what? He said, you know, you're heavy metal. And I said, what's that?
I first heard the term heavy metal in Steppenwolf's Born to Be Wild. Heavy metal thunder, listen with the wind. If any magazine writer, you know, deserves credit for coining the term as a descriptive license plate for this music, it would be heavy metal Mike Saunders.
Noviembre de 1970, el autor Mike Saunders, un universitario del estado de Arkansas que escribía reseñas musicales, fue el primero que utilizó el término para definir el disco As Safe As Yesterday Is de Humble Pie. Y así fue que el heavy metal fue utilizado para definir la música pesada. Nadie estaba seguro de lo que significaba este término y en qué bandas aplicaba, ni en ese entonces ni ahora.
There is a passion within metal fans over what really is metal.
Rage Against the Machine's not metal.
Kiss is not metal.
Van Halen to me is not metal.
AC/DC could maybe be construed as a metal band.
AC/DC is not metal.
Led Zeppelin are one of the original metal bands.
Led Zeppelin, in my opinion, are definitely not a metal band. I think they're a classic hard rock band. But the thing about Led Zeppelin is, in a way, they gave birth to heavy metal.
Formados en 1968, Led Zeppelin, al igual que Black Sabbath, venían de Birmingham, Inglaterra. Pero en los 70, mientras Sabbath creaba sus sonidos siniestros, Zeppelin dominaba al mundo con otro tipo de metal que no era tan pesado, pero que estaba decorado con sensualidad y con lo oculto y revolucionario a su manera.
Led Zeppelin is the archetype of the ultimate heavy metal band.
I got something you want to know.
Robert Plant is absolutely the creator of the metal vocal style. That high singing and that range, that was unheard of.
Jimmy Page was, in my book, like the first heavy metal rock star icon guitar player.
The thing that differentiated Led Zeppelin is the fact they had John Bonham on drums, which was totally unique for the time.
I think he had the most to do with metallicizing Led Zeppelin.
Zeppelin was, you know, another stratosphere. The guitar playing, the style, the look, the mysticism, it's all very metal.
Jimmy Page became fascinated with the work of an English writer named Aleister Crowley. And Crowley was a famous philosopher, writer, magician, and Satanist who thrived in England between the First and Second World Wars. And so Jimmy Page began collecting some of Crowley's artifacts. And his crowning piece of his collection was he bought this old haunted house on the shores of Loch Ness called Boleskin House, which Crowley had once owned. That got him this reputation as this sort of magically inclined guy.
I've been dazed and confused so long it's not true. Why did a woman never bargain for you?
There was the whole thing about Led Zeppelin. If you played a certain song backwards, you know, there would be a message to the devil or whatever. My friends and I, we used to play it and light candles and scare ourselves. And I remember one time his 80-year-old grandma came in the room and she was like, had a crucifix in her hand, and she was like, ay, Dios mío, el demonico Satan, you know, why are you guys listening to this stuff in Spanish, you know? And that's kind of how it was back then, you know, we would scare ourselves with bands like Led Zeppelin.
What is the message that you're trying to get across, if each of you might answer?
Forget about what everybody tells you you're supposed to be doing when you're listening to us, and enjoy yourself.
Led Zeppelin era una banda rodeada de misterio y perpetuaron esta imagen con la portada de su obra maestra sin título de 1971. Cada canción de ese disco se volvió un clásico, pero de todas las canciones sobresalía una.
And Jimmy just takes over.
I think Jimmy showed metal players that they could have ambition, that they could do different things other than just play power chords.
Having as much power that Jimmy had with his guitar, and then being able to go to something as beautiful as the mandolins he used in some of the songs, that takes tremendous talent.
Zeppelin threw the doors open to everything that they wanted to write about and experience. They went everywhere.
Para 1971, las fórmulas básicas para todo metalero estaban listas. El sonido pesado y rasposo de Sabbath y el sonido del buen rock concertista de Zeppelin.
I do think that seemingly every metal band, at its core, is fundamentally using the template Sabbath set or the template that Zeppelin set.
It was the early days, you know, everything was sort of emerging. The first Sabbath record, Led Zeppelin, I mean, what's metal? I don't know, no one knows yet. It's just a bunch of bands that are gone berserk, but they've laid the groundwork.
There are so many rock heroes. We need a rock villain. I want to be the rock villain.
Popular in high school?
No.
No.
With the police, I was popular. I was the guy that dressed different than everybody in the whole school, and I had very few friends.
At that age, man, you're looking for any sort of expressionism, something that's going to make you different, where you raise your head above the crowd and you go, hey, hello, here I am, look at me.
Actualmente la letra de las canciones de las bandas de metal es agresiva y oscura, típico. Pero a principios de los 70, Norteamérica aún no estaba lista para las presentaciones de Vincent Damer Farnier, el rechazado más notable de Norteamérica y mejor conocido como Alice Cooper.
Nobody ever tried to do what Alice did. Nobody ever tried to be this sort of bizarre vaudevillian character. Alice Cooper believed fast cars, blondes, switchblades, sensationalism. We wanted to be the National Enquirer of rock and roll. There are so many rock heroes. We need a rock villain. I want to be the rock villain.
Alice Cooper grew up on horror movies as much as grew up on rock and roll. He was the combination of Bela Lugosi, Chuck Berry, Vincent Price, and everything that actually led up to the formation of the Alice Cooper Band.
I want to be the personified Captain Hook of rock. I don't want to be Peter Pan. I want to be Snidely Whiplash. I want to be the guy that wants the rent money. And I enjoyed playing the heavy. We fashioned a lot of Alice Cooper under the Betty Davis character in Whatever Happened to Baby Jane. That makeup she wore, the smeared makeup, that's where I got that. Because there was something just so creepy about her.
Cooper llevó el metal oscuro británico un paso más adelante. Su notable gira Billion Dollar Babies en 1973 fue un perverso show de horror, adornado con violencia, necrofilia y bebés muertos.
We were trying to create something that hadn't been done. And what hadn't been done was nobody had taken the lyrics and brought them to life. If you had a lyric like Dead Babies, with Alice, there's just no two ways about it. You have to show the audience that, not just sing about it. You use the stage as a canvas and you bring it to life.
Going to a concert became something more than like a bunch of guys on stage playing their new songs. Once those doors shut on the arena, it does like turn into hell.
Heavy metal's always been about horror. If it was to be classified in the same way as we classify books or movies, heavy metal would fit in the horror section.
An alienated young person is drawn to things that are dark. You're going through terrible transitions of being a teenager or whatever, and darkness feels real good to you.
I'm attracted to the evil. Period. You know, I always was as a kid, you know, I was like, the worst stuff I could find, I'm like, that's what I want to buy.
Some people take comfort in fluffy bunnies during adolescence. Some people like to take out the vivid, technicolor, violent fantasies and draw them on the back of exercise books. And then one day a band comes along that kids just go, that's exactly what I'm feeling now.
I remember one time I was watching TV with my dad, and I must have been about 15 or 16 years old, and Alice Cooper was on TV, and you know, and I'm sitting there watching, my dad's sitting next to me, and I have no idea what's going through his head, and I'm watching, and all of a sudden I hear this voice, and it's my dad, and he looks over at me like this, and he's talking through his teeth like this, and he's really mad, you know, and he looks over at me, he goes, if you ever look like that, I will kill you. And I'm sitting there thinking to myself, yeah, Dad, wait till they get a load of me.
My reputation sort of precedes me, you know, as far as killing chickens and biting people's heads off and killing babies. I never did that, for one thing.
Have you
Colonel Sanders kills chickens. I don't know.
We always had the taste not to do any language, bad language on stage, or no nudity. Because that was too cheap, too easy. To us, that was like, well, that gives it all away. You know, what you do is you suggest. If you just suggest, then you don't have to do it. Our stage show was as bizarre as it could get, but I always saw it as being fun. In fact, Groucho Marx loved the show because he saw the burlesque in it. Him and he brought Mae West to one of the shows. Mae West and Groucho Marx watching an Alice Cooper show. And neither one of them were fazed at all. The audience was going, oh, Groucho Marx. I'm looking for the sign and see Groucho Marx and Mae West going, it's good vaudeville.
El heavy metal aprendió una valiosa lección. Alterar vende. La fórmula de Alice Cooper se sigue usando hoy. Evidentemente no nada más en los escenarios, sino que también en las letras, videos musicales y portadas de discos.
The idea of opening the commercial floodgates of theatricality to rock and roll was something that I think we were responsible for. You're so far out on the limb when you're Alice Cooper that you're either going to be the biggest idiot of all time or you're going to be considered like a groundbreaking genius, you know.
Every time I'll see somebody do something, I go, you can find some old concert of Alice and go, look, he already did it. You completely ripped him off.
I like it.
He
did everything first. It's sickening.
Nobody knew what they looked like. You didn't know whether underneath Gene's makeup he was like a murderer. You didn't know.
¿Qué tal si hubiera cuatro Alice Cooper? ¿Qué tal si hubiera cuatro tipos que pudieran ampliar los límites del heavy metal? ¿Qué tal si estos tipos vieran el alma del metal y vieran signos de dólares?
Nobody knew what they looked like. That might seem trivial, but it wasn't. You didn't know whether underneath Gene's makeup he was like a murderer. You didn't know.
What do you represent?
Destruction.
Destruction.
Yeah, rock and roll. Just power.
Energy.
Yeah. And it really was like real living superheroes. That's how I got into Kiss, was because they had their own comic printed in their own blood. I was like, off they do. What?
It's a big spectacle, right? What is most important to you, the spectacle or the music?
The audience.
The audience.
And then to see them on stage breathing fire and spitting blood, believe me, at the age of 11, that's pretty cool.
Historically, people will not remember the music of Kiss. What they will remember is the idea of Kiss.
People are fascinated with Gene spitting blood. People are fascinated with my guitars exploding and rockets going off, and you know, it's larger than life.
It's showbiz.
Some people are hams. I'm the whole pig. I wanted to come out on stage and just take over. Look at me, I'll take my shirt off, I'll shake my ass, whatever it takes.
Here from Kiss is Gene Simmons.
It was always about entertainment and about impact.
Are you a bat?
Actually, what I am is evil incarnate.
Each of us created our own personas. I became the demon. Paul wanted to become the rock star. That's what he always felt like. And Peter had a fascination with cats. And Ace, of course, is from another planet.
In the early days, when we would go on stage, there would be people hysterical laughing at us, you know, and the great feeling was I'm looking at them thinking, you won't be laughing when this is over.
Pero la campaña de Kiss, Metal Comic Book, casi se quema por completo. En 1975 estuvieron de gira sin parar, pero su llamativo espectáculo no se refleja en la venta de los discos. A punto de perder su contrato, tomaron una decisión arriesgada. Sacaron a la venta el primer disco grabado en vivo de heavy metal.
You wanted the best and you got it. The hottest band in the land, Kiss.
The beauty of it is you feel like you're at a concert, and the bombs going off from the opening intro to the last bomb, you can almost feel like you can get contact high listening to that record.
Kiss Alive vendió más de 4 millones de copias y llevó a la banda al mega estrellato. Pero lo más importante, invitó a los fans del metal a que fueran a ver el espectáculo ellos mismos.
People always ask me, what's the best concert you ever saw? And I always say, are you counting Kiss concerts? Because the 13 best shows I've ever seen are 12 Kiss shows and one Prince show.
Everything with Kiss is bigger, better, louder, more. Everything we take to the max.
A wall of amps, you know, I mean, just powerhouse, God of Thunder, Gene Simmons flying. It's amazing.
Oh my God, and then the blood in, he blows the fire, Gene Simmons.
I want to fly to the ceiling. I want to blow fire. I want to spit blood in your face.
I got on the yellow brick road, and I went down the wormhole, and I've never returned since.
Never deluded ourselves with anything except the following. It's our job to make a complete spectacle out of ourselves, period. Stand guilty as charged of the harshest criticism. Ah, those guys make a complete spectacle out of themselves. You're damn right we do. We're serious about making sure our fans get their money's worth.
Después del Live Album vino el disco de platino Destroyer en 1976, y al año siguiente una encuesta lo confirmó: Kiss era la banda más popular en Norteamérica.
How long have you been waiting in line?
For about 13 hours now.
The line stretched around the sports arena. The numbers into the thousands.
Con Kiss Army eran cientos de miles de fanáticos con una insaciable sed de Kiss. La banda se lanzó a un estadio nunca antes explorado por Sabbath, Zeppelin o Cooper. La comercialización.
Kiss. Cha-ching.
This is Kiss, each sold separately.
T-shirts, posters, if they made it, I bought it.
Put them in any crazy pose you want.
A Bobby doll, a sleeping bag, a lunchbox. I mean, after I go to the office next, I'd see some of this stuff, I go, no, you're not going to put that out. They go, oh yeah, this is going out.
Kiss, each 12.5-inch figure sold separately by Mego.
You know, when we started with merchandise, it was considered very uncool. Merchandise to us is something that goes hand in hand with rock and roll.
I read once where someone said how most bands want to be the Beatles and Kiss wanted to be Coca-Cola. And that's completely true.
The Kiss Radio.
Kiss has never really ever had an agenda besides capitalism.
So call or send your money now. Here's how to get your Kiss Radio.
And that did transfer over to, I think, a lot of the bands in the 1980s, especially among the Sunset Strip bands in L.A. There was a very conscious understanding that you're not successful when your record is good. You're successful when everybody has your record.
El comercializar no volvió a los integrantes de Kiss millonarios. Su nombre estaba en una posición precaria. Era una banda metalera con su credibilidad pendiendo de un hilo. Kiss continuó con un nuevo proyecto.
Wonder who could have done it.
Good question, Catman. What do you compute, Space Ace?
Insufficient data at the moment, Starchild. We'd better look into it.
Kiss Meets the Phantom started with a great idea. Let's make a movie that crosses Star Wars and A Hard Day's Night. Conceptually, it sounds great. When you realize that there was a script and there were lines to memorize and none of us had the slightest clue as to what it took to act, the whole project turned into a debacle. I mean, it was just a disaster.
We've got to find Devereaux.
That's screwing me, Starchild. I'm down to my last few lives.
I remember being at the screening of it, and by the end of it, I was so low in my chair that I wanted to, like, crawl out of the theater.
There was such an uprising in the underground metal community. I was offended. I wasn't just disappointed, I was personally offended.
If I hear you calling,
I would get punched out by Led Zeppelin fans that hated Kiss. He sucks, you know, and I would get beat up for liking that band.
It was getting too light. It was getting too poppy. We were getting too, you know, it was just, we were losing our edge, man.
Beth, what can I do?
It's not often you see a little guy with a guitar and shorts running around in the audience.
The great thing about Angus Young, this whole schoolboy shtick, he represents this eternal youth in all of us.
On the surface, heavy metal seems to be more rebellious than other forms of music. Is it?
Yes. Rock and roll is rebellion with no cause, just for its own sake. We won't please Mum and Dad America, you know. Well, I tell you what, Mum and Dad America, how's that?
A finales de los 70, el heavy metal necesitaba ayuda. Kiss había embotado al género con videos caricaturescos y juguetes para niños, pero al mismo tiempo, un nuevo tipo de música volvió a encender al metal. Bandas como Motorhead, Girls' School y Saxon agitaron los ritmos y reemplazaron las letras melosas con historias de alcohol y sexo barato. El metal se estaba divirtiendo. Y ninguna banda lo vivía más que AC/DC.
People love AC/DC because of the atmosphere that they create. They're fun. They're just a barroom band playing on a giant stage with inflatable dolls.
The vibe was that it's like lock up your daughters. We had that sort of image, you know, a bit kinky sometimes. I think they thought I was some sort of male stripper at some point.
Originarios de Sydney, Australia, la banda se formó en 1973 por los hermanos Malcolm y Angus Young. Después de ver las letras AC/DC en una máquina de coser, su hermana sugirió que las usaran como nombre, a pesar de las connotaciones del título.
We were in a taxi, and he said, "So what's the band called?" I said, "AC/DC." He goes, "Well, you know what that means, don't you? You guys aren't all gay." He said, "What? You're looking for trouble, pal, you know?" He said, "No, no, seriously, all the cab drivers say, you know, if you're bisexual, it's, you know, AC/DC, 50-50. We're going, "Oh, we better change the name."
Pero el nombre se quedó igual que la creciente reputación de AC/DC. Eran escandalosos, descarados. Y el guitarrista daba saltos con un uniforme escolar.
Not often you see a little guy with a guitar and shorts running around in the audience.
The great thing about Angus Young, this whole schoolboy shtick, is he represents this eternal youth in all of us.
Las locuras de Angus Young eran el complemento perfecto para liderar al cantante Bon Scott, cuya imagen de chico malo impactó al público.
Bon was genuinely someone who would walk off stage, go to the bar, stand there, stand his round and talk to anybody. To me, one of the true great frontmen of rock and roll.
En 1976, AC/DC estrenó High Voltage, el primero en una lista de álbumes clásicos. También se reubicaron en Londres, donde de pronto se sintieron mal interpretados.
When AC/DC came to London, they were regarded as a punk band, unbelievably. They looked different and they sounded different, and the punks felt that AC/DC could belong to them.
La situación apremiante de AC/DC se dio a notar. Lo punk era lo nuevo, y su agresiva rebelión de tres acordes retó al reino del metal como la opción musical para la afectada juventud del Reino Unido.
Gotta get out there and shove it down people's throats, you ideas.
The late 70s, Britain was completely falling apart. The whole country was going on strike. There were pitched battles in the streets. So in this whole background, punk appeared.
Punk became very political. And metal was never really political.
It was rebellious, you know, upset your granny. And it was all great stuff.
El punk estaba hecho a la medida para los encabezados y los tabloides británicos se lo comieron. Ahora, oficialmente, el metal había pasado de moda.
Suddenly everybody was in a punk band and didn't even have to play a note. Just stand there and make noise and shove a safety pin through your nostril.
You had this mass exodus of all these musicians going over to join that kind of movement. There was nowhere really for rock and metal and blues artists to play.
Every metal band was like, "Woo, you know, what's all this about?" Because record companies changed their thinking overnight, radio stations changed their thinking overnight, all the media magazines changed their thinking overnight, and metal became a dirty word.
Al mismo tiempo, en los Estados Unidos, otro movimiento musical estaba generando toda la atención.
Dude, I have to say, being a child in the 70s, I did not hate disco like when it first came out. You know, I mean, I'm sorry to say that, especially on this show. But but it got really old really quick. It wasn't metal.
Whatever it was. Lo que sea que fuera, la música disco atrajo los gustos de Kiss, cuya credibilidad ya estaba en duda. Para los fieles del metal, esto fue un insulto más.
Kiss sold out in the worst possible way when they put a disco record out and cut their hair. It was heinous.
It's like if Batman all of a sudden started wearing a ballerina suit. Oh, damn, Batman! The Incredible Hulk started wearing a thong, you know? And tassels on his nipples.
We lost some fans because of that record. It was one of our biggest hits, but it was also one of our biggest blunders.
Conforme los 70 le dieron paso a una nueva década, el heavy metal enfrentó algunos problemas serios. Ozzy Osbourne dejó Black Sabbath, y una cultura de exceso acabó con las vidas del cantante de AC/DC, Bon Scott, y del baterista de Led Zeppelin, John Bonham. La muerte había marcado el fin para la legendaria banda.
There was no room for replacements. There was no room to have anybody. You know, that was secondary. The idea of continuing by sticking somebody else back there on the roster was... It's bad taste.
Parecía que el metal iba de salida.
It was a tough time for everybody in the metal world to try and, you know, cling on through those years. You know, what are we going to do here? How are we going to make this survive?
There was a concerted effort to kill it off. You know, this music is finished. You know, it's dead. It will never ever happen again. It's over.